Hanover Square Press and Harper Audio present Who's That Girl? A Memoir by Eve with Kathy Iandoli. This is Eve. Preface: The Gift and the Curse. When I was little, I was convinced that I was cursed with the name Eve. Who could blame me, really? My grandma was a Jehovah's Witness, and she would bring me to the Kingdom Hall for worship, where all I ever heard about was how bad Eve was. Nobody liked her ass. She's literally described in the Bible and other holy books as the reason why there's evil in this world. I mean, Eve made Adam bite the apple, even though he gave her his rib. You know the story. It doesn't matter your religion or your faith, everybody figures that Eve was bad news. So to be named Eve? Imagine carrying that around in your head all day, thinking that you're named after the woman who invented original sin. Ugh. I wanted answers. I'd ask my mom all the time why she named me that, and eventually she told me that I just look like one. Wow. Okay. My middle name is Jihan, J-I-H-A-N, an alternate spelling of J-A-H-A-N, because my mother liked the name Shah Jahan, who was the Mughal emperor of India who built the Taj Mahal. At least I had that going for me. So my name is Eve Jihan, and honestly, there really is much more to my name, but I didn't learn just how important it was until I was much older. The name Eve actually means the first woman, or the first lady in the Bible, and Jihan is Persian for the world or the universe. So technically, my name means the first woman of the universe. When I really understood what that meant, I mean, when it really clicked for me, you couldn't tell me shit after that. I knew I was put here for a reason, and I channeled all of that gumption into adopting this by any means necessary attitude in the game, where I was going to get things done regardless. My mother used to tell me that as a kid, if someone told me no or that I couldn't do something, I would go ahead and do it anyway. So subconsciously, I always embodied that name without realizing it. I was never the type to be told that I can't, no matter what it was, because in my mind, I always could regardless. It's also the main reason why I never competed with anyone. If I knew I had a specific purpose on this planet and knew what my name meant, then how would I look sizing myself up next to someone else? I've just never really cared about competition with other people. Okay, except for maybe one. September 14th, 1999 was the date that my debut album hit the streets. Let There Be Eve, Ruff Ryders' First Lady. The title alone showed the world I was, in fact, Eve, the first woman of the Ruff Ryders universe. It was a moment that I had waited for my whole life, and the culmination of everything I had worked toward. On the day my album was released, I found out that Jay-Z had called and wanted to talk to me, and it was like an added layer of excitement. A few years ago, there was this question that was posed on social media about whether you'd take $500,000 or have a meeting with Jay-Z. When Jay-Z called me in 99, I technically had both. I mean, he'd only been active in the music industry for a few years at that time, but his name rang bells. So it meant something to get a phone call from Jay-Z. I expected a congratulations from him, and I got it. Well, sort of. He did open the call with congratulations, but then he chased it with something like, "But don't be too upset because female hip-hop albums don't really do that well." Huh? Now, let's be clear. In 1999, no one was doing as good as they could have been doing in hip-hop or any other genre because Napster had just come out that summer. The whole game was on high alert, and everybody was throwing around terms like music piracy, or as we like to call it in hip-hop, bootlegging. But for Jay-Z to call me and explain to me how the odds were stacked against me as a woman when everyone was fighting an uphill battle was ballsy. So I had to show him. To me, it felt more like a challenge than an insult. A battery was immediately put in my back. In that moment, it felt like another male roadblock on my ride to fame. Before my album even touched record store shelves, I had already been through that major label rent cycle of being signed, unsigned, then signed again. All at the hands of men who loved my lyrical talent. Yet if I opened my mouth to voice anything but a bar, I was a problem. My debut album went to number one on the Billboard 200, making me the third female rapper in history to achieve that feat. It went double platinum, which again, in 99, was hard for anyone to do. But I did it. Take that, Napster. Take that, Jay-Z. So yeah, I channeled my ambitions and frustrations into competing with Jay, or at least Jay's perception of the success of women in hip-hop. And you may find that ironic, but I needed someone that I had to consistently prove wrong. Some might laugh that I chose him. I doubt he would stare at himself in the mirror and ask, "What would Eve do?" I get it. Look, we all have our own invisible bully, the person we battle in our minds, so to speak. Sometimes it's your coworker always giving you backhanded compliments about your performance in the company, celebrating your wins, yet always making sure to add a caveat. And in many ways, Jay-Z was that coworker and hip-hop was our company. So my innate response was to tip over the proverbial water cooler and flip some desks on the way to the corner office. Jay and I have always been cool, and I'm sure he never even knew what that call did for my drive. Now he does, and I guess I should thank him for it. The reality, though, is he was just a representation of the real bully for me and so many other women, the music industry. Our success stories are always undersold. Even when we're lapping men, we're still called slept on or underrated as a means of keeping us below the industry sea level. For me, it was simultaneously being called the pit bull in a skirt and the underdog. My moves were drowning out those words, but they were still used to keep me down. I'm speaking both for myself and other women here, especially Black women. Telling me that I was going to fail wasn't protecting my fragile female heart from disappointment. It was perpetuating a cycle that I wanted to break. Did I do that? Many times. Sometimes I won, sometimes I lost. But eventually I realized that if the music industry wasn't going to let me be the first woman of their universe, then I had no choice. I had to leave and go build my own. 1. Murder Street. When you look at a map of Philadelphia, it almost resembles the shape of a hand making the peace sign. I guess it's only right that it's called the City of Brotherly Love, though sometimes that nickname is a little ironic, if you ask me. Philly was my home, though, and no matter where I've gone since then, it still is. I was born on November 10th, 1978, at Penn Presbyterian Hospital in West Philadelphia. My mother, Julie, was 17 when she had me and named me Eve Jahan Jeffers. My father, Jerry, was around the same age and played bass in a band. That's how my parents first met. He also used to DJ in my grandmom's basement during the summer. He filled that basement with people, and as a little kid, I'd go there to watch him spin soul records. For the first part of my childhood, my mom's family and I all lived in one apartment in the high rises of the Mill Creek Housing Project in West Philly. You want to talk about a full house? It was me, my mom, my grandma, my granddad, my Aunt Karen, my Uncle Johnny, and eventually my cousin Takia. I was 6 when she was born. We were packed into a 4-bedroom place where I shared a bedroom with my mom. Aunt Karen and Takia shared a room. My grandparents had theirs, and then my Uncle Johnny had his own. So basically, my whole family lived under one roof. I do have 2 other uncles, my Uncle Jimmy and my Uncle Jeffrey. Uncle Jimmy was in and out of prison for a lot of my life. Uncle Jeffrey wasn't allowed around the house when my granddad was home. I never asked any questions about that. As a little kid, it felt like West Philly was just a whole lot of big buildings on top of other big buildings, including my own at Mill Creek. The story of Mill Creek goes that the 3 high-rise buildings in our projects and all of the surrounding low-rises were built on top of this one creek, Mill Creek. So the land was never actually steady enough to hold anything up. The foundation could literally cave in at any moment, and the residents just had to live with that hanging over their heads every single day. So on top of all the other fears you could have while living in West Philadelphia, I could add being swallowed up by the earth to my list. Mill Creek eventually became famous again in 2000 for something called the Lex Street Massacre, when 4 guys shot 10 people in a crack house on Lex Street over a busted up car and some drug money. 7 of them died and 3 were injured. It made history as the deadliest mass murder in all of Philadelphia. That was right around where I grew up. Now everything is knocked down and they planted a sustainable community farm there. The creek is still sitting right under it. After my cousin Takia was born, we all moved down to the low-rise houses on a little street called Olive Walk. The narrow street had all these red brick box houses, and each shared a wall and a stoop with the next house to it. We had a little grass. I wouldn't call it a park or anything, but it was enough to play on, and you can see one of the high-rise buildings right in front of us, along with a big-ass empty field across the street where nothing was ever built. If you walk through the alleyways and over to the high-rises, you'd reach the main road named Meredith Street, but everyone knew it as Murder Street. That nickname needs no explanation. The streets of West Philadelphia were checkered with guns and crack, and the unfortunate victims were the people who lived along those streets. Some dying from violence, others from overdoses. Pick your poison. I never really understood that aspect of Philly until I was a little older. I just knew it was this big city to me, one that I would spend most of my time staring at through the train windows on the L. At home, I always felt like my surroundings were so dark. It's hard to explain. We would go to our neighbor's house, and sometimes their home just felt so much lighter. It wasn't like we had darker wallpaper or paint on the walls, but even as a kid, I just felt a darker aura in my home. My granddad had gradually developed a drinking problem, so sometimes he would come home drunk at night, turn on all the lights in the house, and just start yelling and arguing with everyone. We walked on eggshells whenever he was around, and every time he came home from work, we'd all run upstairs and hide. Then one day, many years later, he just changed and became this smiling, lighthearted person. It was crazy, but a welcome switch. He stopped drinking, but I can't just credit it to that. In my adult years, dealing with my own relationship with alcohol, I learned to acknowledge that come-to-Jesus moment because it was a total energetic shift that I noticed in him and later me. He wasn't very affectionate for most of my life, though. Like, the first time he hugged me was in my 30s, and I was freaked out. My grandma's a Jehovah's Witness, which is how I wound up at the Kingdom Hall. She's still devout, too, waiting for those 144,000 to be saved or go to heaven. My grandparents were always a mystery to me, even though my entire childhood was spent living with them. My cousin Takia and I used to joke and say they must have been like Bonnie and Clyde on the run and moved to Philly to set up a new life. Their backstory was a total secret. All I knew was that my granddad was from Mississippi and was in the military, and my grandma was from Ohio and had a sister who she used to write to. And that's all I really know about them to this day. Since my grandma was a Jehovah's Witness, we didn't celebrate Christmas in our home or any birthdays. But I would watch The Sound of Music and The Nutcracker when they aired during the holidays, and that was my own little Christmas. My mom still bought me gifts, though, and since my Aunt Karen loved the holidays, she'd celebrate with us outside of the house. On my father's side, the whole family is from North Carolina, so I spent my summers there from age 6 until I was about 12. My grandparents, his parents, lived up the street from me in Philly, so I could literally walk up the hill to their house to visit them and spend time with my dad. Eventually, though, he stopped showing up, but I still did. And as much as I love my grandparents and my cousins, they weren't the ones I wanted to be with. I wanted to be with my dad. He admitted to me years later that he had a drug problem, and that's why he kept away from me, which I respected. And he never tried to show up once I became famous, like, "Daddy's home." I respected that too. But as a kid who just wanted to hang out with her dad, I didn't know what was going on when he started vanishing back then. So I matched his energy, and one day I said, "I'm done," and stopped going to visit him at my grandparents' house. I couldn't take it anymore and had to tell myself, "I'm good." He just kept disappointing me, not showing up when I invited him to my school graduations or anything else. When my mom and I moved further away, it got easier for me to space out the visits too. I held on to that anger though, and I wasn't afraid to show him whenever I did see him. He and his brothers used to call me Evil Eve because I was always pouting when I was around them. I never smiled and always had an attitude. As an adult, I realized it was just me trying to get a response out of my dad. Something. I also realized that same anger fueled my desire and need to be seen and heard throughout most of my early adult life. I channeled all that rage when I first picked up a microphone, but as a kid, I just wanted my dad's attention. Though honestly, I always wanted everyone's attention. When you're living in a packed house with all adults and one bassinet holding your baby cousin, It's not easy to get the attention you're seeking. So my little dramatic ass would find any corner of the house where everyone was within earshot. And I'd sit down and sing a little song I'd made up. Nobody loves me. Nobody cares. Did I really believe that? Of course not. But I figured I could Jedi mind trick them into playing with me or hearing all about my...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.